Is etiopathogenesis of psoriasis. Don't get scared. I'll try to keep it simple. And etiopathogenesis of psoriasis. Start with what is psoriasis? It is a disease that is chronic with the remissions and relapses going throughout its course, and inflammatory, immune mediated, but not truly autoimmune. Non-contagious in nature and hyperproliferative skin disease with increased epidermal turnover. Primarily considered a skin disease, and most of the time it is so. It is primarily a skin disease, but it may involve the multiple systems in the body. Psoriasis is a heterogeneous disease. It can present in different morphologies, different nature of onset, age of onset, its clinical course. But in most cases, it presents as erythematous, indurated, scaly, well-demarcated plaques involving predominantly the extensor surfaces of the body, like the back, extensor surfaces of the knees, elbows, and scalp. And on the back, the predominant area of involvement is sacral region. So these are the pictures showing these areas of involvement. Here is the involvement of the scalp. Well-demarcated plaque extending beyond the margin of the scalp with the silvery scales, and erythematous hue can still be seen through the scales. This is again the site of predilection, extensive surface of the knee, then again back, erythematous plaques with heaved up scales, again sacral area, its site of, and you can see the dorsal surface of the hand, involvement of the scalp with the psoriasis. Now, coming to the epidemiology, there is wide variation in reported prevalence in different populations. It may range from 0.9% to 8.5%. 0.9% is the prevalence reported in US, and 8.5, which is quite high, has been reported in Norway. This wide variation can be due to difference in ethnicity, in genetic susceptibility, environmental or climate. They can all lead to these, and methodology also of the studies which were done to give these reports. In Pakistan, I got a figure which was published in an article in Express Tribune in 2015 on World Psoriasis Day. It was 2 to 4%. But personally, as a dermatologist, I feel that this is basically the tip of the iceberg. The main body of the iceberg is still lurking within the general population, untreated or presenting to the general practitioners. So that body is not presenting to us. So this figure can be true, but maybe more than this also. And regarding the age, there are two peaks of onset according to the age. It's 16 to 22 years and 57 to 62 years. Now, 16 to 22 years, these two peaks of onset led to the concept of two different types of psoriasis. One presenting in the early age is the type 1, which is hereditary, strongly HLA linked, and tend to be more severe, presents early, more severe, and the family history is usually positive because it is hereditary. And the type 2, 57 to 60 year, it is sporadic, not linked to the family history, not linked to the HLA, and tend to be mild. But of course, there are women and men are equally affected, though some studies show that there is bias towards the male predominance, and the males present tend to present with a more severe disease and tend to have a more systemic therapies as compared to women. And now the main pathogenesis of psoriasis, there are basically three key factors related to the pathogenesis of psoriasis. First one is genetics. That is of paramount importance, we have already discussed, in especially in type 1 presenting in early age. Then the environmental factors, and the interplay of these two factors, genetic and environmental factors, lead to immune dysregulation, and these three together lead to the psoriasis. Genetics, I would not go into the detail of the genetics, but I would like to state some important facts that might be of practical importance regarding genetics, like the prevalence of psoriasis in first degree relative is 7.8%. So it is quite judicious to inquire about family history in patients with psoriasis. Now, the lifetime risk of psoriasis in a person is 4% if none of the parents is affected, 28% quite high if one of the parents is affected, and 65% if both the parents are affected. Two types of psoriasis based on hereditary component, again type 1 hereditary and type 2 sporadic, already discussed.
Some studies prefer that the familial psoriasis is present obviously in the early age, support an autosomal dominant pattern. Some studies support that the double recessive model, but the major consensus over the pattern of polygenic, that is polygenic and multifactorial. And then another interesting effect that there's preferential paternal effect, earlier age of onset and more severe disease when inherited from father. Then about the concordance of psoriasis in various international studies, 20% for monozygotic twin and 9% for dizygotic twins. But you see that the percentage is 20%, not 100%. So you can understand that it is genetic, but environmental factors are necessary when it comes to the presentation or exacerbation or onset of psoriasis. Psoriasis represents thus a spectrum of genetic diseases. Like at one end, there are families, which is obviously rare, with only one single gene mutated, you get the psoriasis. But at the other end, more commonly changes in multiple genes interacting with environment. Now the molecular genetics, over 40 genes have been discovered involved in the disease causation. Most of them relate to the antigen presentation. Most common is HLA-C or SORS1, commonly called. It is responsible for 35 to 50% of the known heritability. Then T cell, particularly Th17 differentiation, NF-kappa-B regulated signaling. Here the SORS2 gene or CAR14 gene is involved, and perturbation of the epidermal barrier. Most of the genes are involved in these four pathways. Now the second part, environmental factors. Environmental factors involve, first of all, infections, streptococcal infection of throat and staphylococcal infection of skin. They can both cause the onset of the disease and the exacerbation of the disease. Like the patient with exacerbation of the disease associated with the sore throat infection of streptococcus, they tend to benefit with a tonsillectomy performed that results in reduction of their cutaneous symptoms. Then staphylococcal infection, not particularly associated with onset, but it can result in exacerbation. And moreover, there is association of sepsis because the staphylococcal carriage is present over the psoriatic skin more than the control population. And then HIV, it can also onset and exacerbation of psoriasis. Second is drugs. We all know they are mostly the culprit in the onset or exacerbation. Lithium, anti-malarials, so be guarded while prescribing anti-malarials. Interferon alpha, NSAIDs, beta blocker, ACE inhibitors, they are all responsible. And the withdrawal of drugs, steroids, they should be withdrawn cautiously. Over 40 milligram, you should taper it over weeks or months. Now, the cyclosporine being given, it can also result in exacerbation. Withdrawal of methotrexate, the patient had already been taking that, then it can result in exacerbation. Then fourth one is alcohol, associated with onset and exacerbation, contributes to low mood and increased cardiovascular risk. And so if a patient with refractory psoriasis presents to you, please don't forget to inquire about alcohol. Smoking, it can also result in increased risk of developing psoriasis, severe disease, and more prominently associated with palmoplantar pustulosis, and particularly in women. Psychological stress, it has a very complex relationship with psoriasis. It can also result in the onset and flare of the disease, and once you get the flare of the disease, it can result in more depression or psychological stress, and a kind of vicious circle start, and you get stress and disease, and disease and stress, it goes on. Neurogenic inflammation may also play a role, like the sensory nerves are increasing the psoriatic plaques, and the neurogenic inflammatory mediators like substance P and calcitonin gene-related peptide, they're also increased in psoriatic plaques, so they can be associated with the, this psychological stress associated exacerbation or now the UVR-related provocation of the disease, usually it is considered that it is beneficial, but in 5 to 25% of the cases reported, there can be exacerbation or onset of the disease after sun exposure. Most commonly, the young women are the people who are most affected by photosensitive psoriasis, and low-dose broadband UVA is the basic key cause. Then A, the physical trauma, cognitive phenomena, cutaneous trauma and old scars, psoriasis can occur in these areas. It is due to initiation of innate immune activation over that point, which results in hyperproliferation of epidermis and the plaques of psoriasis. It can occur in up to 25% of patients. More common in hereditary HLA-associated psoriasis, and it is more common during the acute stage of psoriasis. Reverse Cobner is the clearing of the skin lesion at the cytochrome that is not associated with the pathogenesis. I'd like to mention it. This is a picture showing the Cobner phenomena. The patient scratched and there is the formation of silvery plaques over the scratch. This is the Cobner phenomena in tattoo. Others this is the basic pathway. I tried to make it simple. The triggers come because the activation of the innate immune system. Whenever there is injury to the epidermis, there is first of all the activation of the innate immune system. Due to activation of the innate immune system and injury, there is increased production of the cathelicidin and beta defensin that bind to self DNA or RNA released by epidermal injury. Thus, there is increased toll-like receptor activation. Now, due to increased toll-like receptor activation, there is increased production of interferons, TNF-alpha, resultant activation of T-cell, then adaptive immunity is activated after the interferon and TNF-alpha production. Basically, there is activation of Th17 cell and its interleukin. So, the cycle starts, activation of the T-cell, production of cytokines that cause epidermis to proliferate, that produce chemokines, more T-cells, more cytokines, more inflammation, more proliferation. So, it goes on like this.
So this is the pictorial representation of the same pathogenesis that due to epidermal injury in pre-psoriatic skin, there is activation of the innate immune that produces cathelicidin LL37 and the self-DNA that is released by injury to the epidermis. They bind together and cause activation of the innate immune system, macrophage activation, Th17 activation. They further perpetuate the epidermal proliferation and activation of the macrophage activation, interleukin production, and T-cell activation. And they further cause the changes that are present in psoriasis. I will be discussing complication and comorbidities together with pathogenesis because they share pathogenesis with psoriasis. They either are due to genetic susceptibility, their associations, then due to treatment related, then again psychological stress that may lead to altered the lifestyle like smoking and alcohol. They can result from these. So it's complications and the same case historically considered primarily a skin disease, not otherwise hazardous. But increased awareness has led to the concept of psoriasis being a systemic disease.
First of all, immune-related, immune-mediated inflammatory disorder like psoriatic arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, particularly Crohn's disease, alopecia areata, vitiligo, infection. I had already discussed that staphylococcal carriage in psoriatic patient is increased up to 50%. And that can result not in exacerbation of the disease, but during surgical procedure, we have to look for the staphylococcal carriage because it may result in sepsis or surgery-related complication. Then streptococcal throat infection, they not only cause the onset or exacerbation of the disease, their psoriasis also predisposes to streptococcal throat infection. Like they have 10 times more likely to get streptococcal throat infection than a normal household contact psoriatic patients, and there are more carriage rates of streptococcal throat infection than in normal population. The psychological stress, again, a vicious cycle. The cancers, these are anecdotal. Cutaneous are mostly related not to the psoriasis per se, but mostly treatment related. Like you have given immune suppressants or PUVA therapies for psoriasis and it may result in cutaneous malignancies. Most commonly, non-melanoma skin cancers like squamous cell carcinoma and basal cell carcinoma. Lymphomas and organ malignancies, there are again anecdotal. Metabolic syndrome is the most important association, so you should look for it in the patient with moderate to severe psoriasis. That is truncal obesity, hyperlipidemias, hypertension, insulin resistance, cardiac disease. The patient with severe psoriasis die at younger age than unaffected people, and cardiovascular disease accounts for the majority of this excess mortality. So need to be guarded or vigilant, at least in patients with severe psoriasis. Stroke, peripheral arterial disease, atrial fibrillation, venous thromboembolism, they're all the causes for morbidity and mortality as well. Then hepatobiliary diseases, alcohol-related and non-alcohol-related steatotic hepatitis. They are both associated, and a viral hepatitis as well. Renal involvement is not so common in psoriasis, but it may occur both in the glomerulonephritis and amyloidosis causing renal failure. But it is not so common. The gout and hyperuricemia is again commonly associated. The pregnancy-associated complication because of hormonal association or association in pathogenesis. The pregnancy-associated complication may be present like eclampsia and pustular psoriasis and others like danger to the fetus. So the take-home message. Psoriasis can be a very troublesome disease and often an intractable disease, but it is rarely dangerous to life. So need to be vigilant, but not so aggressive. It is impossible to say in any particular case how long the disease will last, whether a relapse will occur, or for what period of time the patient will remain free from psoriasis. We cannot tell or pinpoint these features in any particular case. There are no markers for this, predicting these features. The complete remission of psoriasis over 1 to 54 years in up to 39 to 50% of the cases. Complete remission can be observed either spontaneously or with treatment. The patient may remain in relapse. The untreated relapse is the rule, but duration of remission again varies greatly. It may be months to year. So lifestyle modification is mandatory in psoriatic patient. To avoid the cardiovascular comorbidities and to avoid psychological stress and the metabolic syndrome, again, associated with metabolic syndrome. That's all for today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Amara. It was a commendable lecture indeed. Now you can put